So here we see, as it was requested by Mother Devahuti, that a proper arrangement of an apartment or a house be made, because the hermitage in which they were living was predominantly in the mode of goodness, meant for practicing austerity and tapasya. So it was not a suitable situation to create a progeny, to increase children, to have family life. So in order to satisfy the desire and to create an appropriate situation, Kardama Muni created a huge castle in the sky. A very big kind of a, it's practically like a big, huge apartment in the sky. So the different features of this castle in air is explained. It was a wonderful structure. Then it was bedecked with all sorts of jewels. We find sometimes the modern scientists have also created some kind of small Sputnik or airplane which travels in the sky. But practically it has no value. It is not made up of some valuable jewels. It is made up of some tin, iron, plastic, all these kind of base materials. But here we find Kardama Muni has created a palatial castle in the sky. So bedecked with all sorts of jewels. The pillars are not made up of some cement or some steel or iron. They are made up of precious stones. And not only that, this castle is a very special castle. Sarva Kama Dugha, Prabhupada says. Sarva Kama Dugham. Yielding whatever one desires. That means generally when we construct a house, when we construct an apartment, in order to maintain the apartment, we have to work hard. But this apartment itself, rather than requiring maintenance, it is able to give all kinds of maintenance. It is able to fulfill all kinds of desires. Such was the kind of castle which Kardama Muni created. Then it was equipped with all kinds of furniture, wealth, and the speciality was, generally, as the time passes by, then the iron, the cement, all the matter, or even whatever we apply, whatever different kinds of valuable things we may use in our apartment, it gradually deteriorates over a period of time. Correct? But here it is mentioned, all the different kinds of valuable jewels which were used by Kardama Muni, they were only increasing and not deteriorating in its opulence. Gradually, our opulence in the material world decreases, but by his mystic power, he created an opulence which was not decreasing, but gradually increasing. So this is what is created by Kardama Muni. Prabhupada is offering a very wonderful insight in the purport. Prabhupada is saying, the castle created in the sky by Kardama Muni, it may be called as a castle in the air. So actually this is a proverb in English. You are building castles in the air. That means imagination. Something which does not exist. A castle or a big palace, a huge apartment or a building, we don't find it exists in the air. It doesn't exist in the sky. It exists on the earth. So, when somebody imagines something, which does not exist in reality, it is only in his imagination, then we say you are building castles in the air. So this is an English saying. So Prabhupada is saying, this castle created by Kardama Muni can also be called castle in the air. Isn't it? But by his mystic power of yoga, Kardama Muni actually constructed a huge castle in the air, which is generally imagination, is actually constructed by Kardama Muni in the air or in the sky. Prabhupada relates a very interesting story about understanding what does it mean when we say building castles in the air. Prabhupada explains that once there was a potter. This potter, he used to sell his pots, and he calculated very intelligently that this pot is costing me 1 rupee. If I have around hundreds of pots now, if I sell it for 2 rupee, that means double the price, then 1 rupee will be my profit, and with hundreds of pots I will make hundreds of rupees. And then he started imagining, if I get hundreds of rupees of profit, with those hundreds of rupees I will invest once again in my business, I will make hundreds of more pots, and again I will sell. Like this my business will increase, pots will increase, business will increase. Then when I have enough money, then I will marry a beautiful wife, and that wife should work very obediently, carry out all my desires, and in case if she does not listen to me, I will kick her. And then in his imagination he started actually kicking, and when he was kicking, he did not know that all his pots, they all broke down, they were all smashed to pieces. So Prabhupada explains, this is our situation in the material world. We are all building castles in the air, just like this pot, just like this potter was doing. And with one kick, all his pots were smashed. Similarly, with the one kick of nature, all our different kinds of big programs, different plans we are making, they will be all kicked out. So this material world, the material happiness, is compared to something like building castles in the air. Why? Because actually this material happiness, behind which we are endeavoring so hard, working so hard, day and night you can see the whole material world is moving like anything. So much of activities are going on. Actually, for what? Just try to understand. It is just for building castles in the air. This is the comparison. It is just like building castles in the air. Why? Why this is compared like this? Srila Vidyapati, a great devotee of the Lord, he has analyzed this very nicely. He says, Tatala Seikate Vari Bindu Sama Sutamita Ramani Samaje. He says that actually the real position of this material world is that this is like a scorching hot desert. Tatala means desert, and sekaite. Sekaite means scorchingly burning desert. You can imagine actually so much temperature that you cannot withstand, you cannot even stand there. Right? And then what is required? Suppose if there is a scorching, burning desert where you cannot even withstand, you cannot stand there, what to think about trying to enjoy in that scorching desert? You require a huge quantity, gallons and gallons of water. Correct? Water is something which can cool the scorching desert. How much water is required? Gallons and gallons. Suppose somebody gives you a drop of water, is it possible to get rid of this scorching heat of the desert? Water has a value, there is no doubt. But a drop of water practically has no value. So he is saying, Srila Vidyapati says, that this material world is practically like the scorching desert in which we are trying to enjoy. And what are we trying to enjoy with? What are we trying to think that the material miseries, the scorching heat of this material world, miserable world, will cool down? We are taking shelter of just a drop of water. What is a drop of water? Vari bindu sama. Bindu sama means drop. Vari means water. What is that? Suta mita ramani samaje. Family, friend, society. In all these things we are taking shelter. And we are thinking that we will be able to get rid of this scorching hot desert. Actually, it is not possible. So, Bhagavatam, that's why very nicely describes this hope of material enjoyment by the living entity as Durashaya. Durashaya means which can never be satisfied. Hopes that can never be satisfied. It's just like building castles in the air, which doesn't exist. It's just our imagination. We are thinking we will be able to enjoy in this material world. So it says, it is hoping against the hope. Durashaya. Why it is called Durashaya? Bhagavatam explains, because we may wonder why it is called as Durashaya. What is the reason? So it says, Bahirartha Manina. It is Durashaya because we have taken shelter of material energy of the Lord. Bahirartha. So what does it mean, taking shelter of material energy of the Lord? Now the material energy of the Lord, by constituents, by its nature, it is temporary. It is not false. The illusion created by this temporary material nature is false. The variety created by it is false. Material energy is not false, but it is temporary. So we have taken shelter of this temporary material energy of the Lord. So that's why it is called as external energy, Durashaya. If we take shelter, our hopes will never be fulfilled. Prabhupada gives an example that it is just like a child. Sometimes he constructs a very nice castle on the beach of an ocean. So you can just imagine, by nature, the place where he has constructed the castle actually supposed to deteriorate. The waves will just sway it away over a period of time. Or, Prabhupada says, the parents will say, my dear son, now our time is over, now let us wind off and go away. He has to leave behind that castle. So our play in the material world is also like this. This material world is practically like that, where we are trying to construct castles in the air or on that sandy beach. With the sand, we are trying to create the castle, which is bound to be swayed away, taken away. Or when our time will come, then we will be kicked out of this material body itself. We will not be able to enjoy the huge palaces. Just like, if you all remember, in one of the classes recently, Prabhupada was giving one very interesting example. Let me see if somebody remembers that very wonderful example. Example of Napoleon. Who remembers? Mantapa? Yeah, what was that Napoleon statue? Yes. So, Prabhupada gave the example. They're writing, Napoleon is France and France is Napoleon. Right? That is what they are writing. That this country is identified with Napoleon, and that Napoleon itself represents that country. So Prabhupada asked this question to them. France is there, but where is Mr. Napoleon? Isn't it? France is there, but where is Mr. Napoleon? We don't even know. Prabhupada gave the example that one of the famous politicians of our country, one astrologer, he predicted that he has become a dog in Scandinavia. So what is the position? We build castles, we build different kinds of big, huge empires, and then we are no more there to enjoy them. Any of those things. Material nature kicks us out. Because this material world is temporary, what we have taken shelter of. So that's why this is called as Durashaya. So, Prabodhananda Saraswati, he explains very beautifully, devotee should never become bewildered. He should not become bewildered by material opulences. He should not get carried away by heavenly pleasures. He should not get carried away by thinking, merging in God, or even by mystic powers. Just like we are seeing here, Kardama Muni, with his mystic power, he has created a castle in the air. Looks like very astonishing, very awesome. Something which living entities may think, we should also get something like this. Isn't it? So, Prabodhananda Saraswati Thakur, he says, devotee should not become carried away by this. And actually, anyone who has achieved even a glance of Lord Chaitanya's mercy, he will never become bewildered by any of those things. Very beautifully he has described. He says, for people, the jnanis, the mental speculators, they work so hard. Not for one lifetime, they work for many lifetimes. For what? To merge in Brahman. Correct? So much austerities they take, so much tapasyas they take. Factually for what? To get merged in Brahman. Brahma Sukha. to attain drop of that happiness called as Brahman. They give up their family life. They kick out all material enjoyment. But devotees don't get attracted even to Brahma Sukha, because the devotee has achieved the mercy of Lord Chaitanya. So what does he compare this Brahma Sukha to be? So Prabodhananda Saraswati says, Narkayate Kaivalyam Narkayate. Merging in Brahman for a devotee is hellish. He will never think, he will never take up. Then further he explains, Tridashapura, the heavenly pleasure enjoyed by Swarga Vasis, the inhabitants of Swarga Loka, they are called Tridashapura. It's like we have Rayapura, right? So like this Swargapuri. So that for a devotee is like castle in the air. It doesn't exist. Will-o-wisp, Phantasmagoria, which has no existence for a devotee. This does not exist. Like Akash Puspayate, the pushpa, the flower, it actually grows on earth. We don't see pushpa in the Akash. So he says, for a devotee, this happiness of heavenly pleasures is like will-o-wisp or a castle in the air. It does not exist for him. Then what about mystic perfection? So much trouble these mystic yogis are taking, controlling their senses. Because after controlling their senses only, they will be able to get mystic powers. Correct? So much austerities they take to control their senses. So, Srila Prabodhananda Saraswati Thakur says, Durdanta Indriya Kala Sarpa Patli Prokthat Damstrayate. For a devotee, the senses are no more like a venomous snake. They become like playful object. It is just like if venomous snakes, poison is taken away, the fangs of poisons are taken away, then it's just like a plaything. Even a child can play with it. So for a devotee, controlling the senses and obtaining mystic powers, it's like a fig. Fig means very simple, doesn't care for it. Why Prabhupada explains this? Because devotees' senses are engaged in the service of the Lord. The poison of the senses are automatically controlled. It's taken away by being engaged in the service of the Lord. And then this material world, which actually all these yogis, they want to renounce. They want to go towards Brahman, Brahma Nirvana. For a devotee, even this material world, which is supposed to be filled with distress, dukhalyam, actually by the mercy of the Lord, becomes Vaikuntha. Vishvam Purna Sukhayate. Otherwise this material world is called Kuntha. But by the mercy of the Lord, this material world becomes Vishvam Purna Sukhayate. What about obtaining positions like Brahma? Secondary creator, the greatest of the being in the material universe, Brahmanda. So, Srila Prabodhananda Saraswati Thakur says, Vidhi Mahendra Adishcha Kitayate. They are just like worms in the stool for a devotee. Just like for a worm, there is no position. So these positions like Vidhi, taking position of a Brahma or Indra is just like Itayate. Why? Yat karunaya kataksha vaibhavatam tam gauram evastumaha. I worship that Lord Chaitanya by whose one glance, mercy of his one glance, the devotee is not attracted by any of them. So actually the devotee of the Lord, he is not attracted, he is not bewildered by these things. Prabhupada in the purport is explaining, it is not some kind of sentiment of a devotee. Prabodhananda Saraswati Thakur is not giving some sentiments here. It's not because of some sentiment. It's based on very scientifically understanding. A devotee understands the reality. In the purport, Prabhupada is explaining what is so great, why a devotee should become bewildered. If the Supreme Lord can create millions and millions of universes, which carries so many castles on every planet and which are all flying in the sky, what is so great? Is it difficult for Kardama Muni, who is a powerful mystic yogi, to create one castle in the air that we become wonderstruck? So it's not something very wonderful. Wonderful is how the Supreme Lord has created millions and millions of these universes which are hanging in the sky, which are floating in the sky like swab of cotton. Right? That is what we should think. Anybody remembers what was the conversation we had in, we were reading today's class, Prabhupada's conversation? Anyone remembers? Guru Kripa? Today's conversation is very enlightening. This is a vision of a devotee. So just like Prabhupada is explaining that devotee is not, you know, very astonished by this. Kardama Muni has created one castle in the air. Why he is not astonished? Because he understands. The Supreme Lord, he has created millions of universes. These millions of universes are floating in the sky with millions of castles. So what is so great about Kardama Muni creating one castle in the air? Not something wonderful. Then Prabhupada is giving another wonderful example. Prabhupada is saying, and nothing to be bewildered about, even Kardama Muni creating a castle with pillars, bedeck jewels which were shining. Prabhupada is saying, when Lord was there on this earthly planet, not in the sky, on earthly planet the Lord created. In Dwarkapuri, the Lord created so many palaces, 16,108 palaces, which did not require any lighting. Prabhupada is saying in the today's purport, if you see, Prabhupada is saying, it was like a lamp light, all these jewels. The castles constructed by Lord Krishna for his lamp light during the night. We make a light, right? To, you know, make some, to get rid of the darkness, to have some light. The Lord created palaces for night light, like a night lamp. So there is nothing to be wondering about, what Kardama Muni has created. So in today's conversation, Dr. Patel was saying the small particle which enters into this body is important, right? That is what he was discussing. This body is a huge body, but actually this body is not very important. The small particle, the soul, which has entered into this body is important. Similarly, Prabhupada is saying, do not get bewildered by this huge universe. It is the Supreme Lord who has entered in this universe, which makes it floating in the sky, which is more important. See how Prabhupada explains so beautifully. So Prabhupada is saying, therefore, those who are materialistic persons, they are amazed with the huge body of this universe. Correct? Scientists, they're all amazed. So much of research work is going on. What is there in this material world? What is beyond this material world? How so many multiple universes are there? So many planets are there? So much of money is being spent trying to go to the different planets. Why? So much they are amazed. So Prabhupada is saying, materialistic people are amazed by this. Those who are materialistic persons, they are amazed with the huge body of this universe. But Arjun is saying, this is on account of your entering. The devotee of the Lord recognizes, this is nothing. This is on account of the Lord entering these material universes. Everything is possible. As this body is developed on account of entering that minute particle of spiritual spark, similarly the innumerable universes, all these universes, they have developed by Krishna's entering as Garbhodakshai Vishnu. That is explained in the last chapter. Prabhupada is saying in 11th chapter this is explained. How this is explained? Athava bahuna etena kim gnatena tava arjuna vishthabhyam idam krishnam. The Lord is saying, it's all just by my entering. And what entering? Ekena amshena. Just by my partially entering, the partial manifestation of the Lord, one of the expansions of the Lord, Garbhodakshai Vishnu enters into this material world. That's how this whole material world has developed. So this is possible. By his one plenary portion, by entering into the material world, so gigantic form is there. Therefore, they cannot understand how Krishna, just like a human being, he can be more important than gigantic cosmic manifestation. So therefore they are bewildered. They go behind this gigantic, huge material universe. They cannot understand that this is developed on account of the Lord entering into this. So this is a very beautiful perception which Prabhupada is giving in today's purport, that actually there is nothing to be bewildered about what Kardama Muni has created, either, you know, with a beautiful, astounding, that palace which is existing in the sky, which may be only just an imagination for all of us, and that too with all kinds of valuable jewels, which were not deteriorating, but always giving light, their lights were only increasing. So Prabhupada is saying there is nothing to be bewildered about that, because if we see the Lord as Yogeshwara, he is the master of all mystic powers. So devotee understanding this, he doesn't become bewildered. Similarly, actually, all of us, even in our material life, we should all understand where is the question of getting bewildered when we see so many materialistic people, materially opulent. Sometimes we give up our devotional service thinking, have I come in the wrong path? Better could have been in my profession if I could have earned some money. So many people are, everybody practically is in that line. Isn't it? That is how. So sometimes Maya may bewilder us, but actually with proper understanding, devotee does not become bewildered by all these things. So we'll stop with this. Grantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai.